Fatima in the Philippines help a cataract patient recover his vision so he may provide for his family once more. Yilan's Nanfang tribal village grows mountain cabbage, which are sweeter than plain ground cabbage.
Welcome to Daily Headlines. I'm Marilu Shioda. Thank you for joining us. We begin today's program in the Philippines, where Edgardo Trinidad had cataracts. Due to this eye problem, he faced the prospect of losing his job as he was unable to afford cataract surgery. To assist, local team members helped him finance the surgery.
This big city hides the pain of the resident.
I almost lost my vision. How can I work? I may be hit by a car whenever I walk on the road.
Diagnosed with cataracts, everything Edgardo sees on the magazine is blurred. Because of his eye problems, he faced the threats of losing his job as a warehouse worker anytime, which also worried his family.
Seeing that my brother has eye problems, I sympathize with him. He's a big financial contributor to our family, as he not only helps pay for the rent, but also other living expenses.
As Edgardo is unable to afford the medical expenses for the surgery, which is equivalent to 5 months' wages, the Philippines Tima chapter helps solve his dilemma.
I feel very happy because he's able to see now and he recognized me right after the surgery. In the past, he always said that he would get back to work right away, even though only one of his eyes regains vision.
Thank you.
After the cataract was finally removed, I was able to see the doctors, and then I saw all the people surrounding me. I felt like jumping for joy.
After regaining vision, Edgardo finally showed a smile on his face, as now he is able to do everything on his own. He also pledges to pay love forward by doing good deeds with Ciji.
After receiving Ciji's assistance, many recipients repay the foundation by doing recycling. Next, we meet Chong Fok Fat from Klang, Malaysia, who is doing just that.
Chong Fu Fa's wife started to undergo dialysis 7 years ago, compounding the family's financial burden. Fortunately, Ciji volunteers provided assistance in their time of need. It was then that Mr. Chong started to form a bond with Ciji.
I have a wish to help others. After receiving assistance from others, we should also pay love forward to them.
When Mr. Chong devoted himself to recycling, the situation was not as he would imagine.
When I did recycling for the first time, I thought it was a little bit dirty. But I heard from some sisters that we can recycle the items that are still reusable. I think what they've said made sense to me.
Now he has become a good helper for the nearby recycling station.
He is a very diligent volunteer. I know he usually drives his wife to receive dialysis every Tuesday and Thursday. He may return to the recycling station at around 11 a.m. He will come whenever I ask him for help.
Over the past year, Mr. Chong dedicated a lot of his time to the recycling station. He also woke up early in the morning to listen to master's teachings.
I'm not very knowledgeable. I thought Master's teachings were reasonable, and I slowly began to put into practice to improve my temperament.
After learning to carry out the act of giving, Mr. Chong also made his life more meaningful by volunteering through recycling.
Next, we'll visit Myanmar. Ciji has helped some local teachers organize a special after-school class to provide extra support for students as they work towards graduating high school and getting into university. They know that only with a good education will they be able to lift their families and their communities out of poverty.
Here in Myanmar, special after-school tutoring for high school students is just getting started. Volunteers in Yangon are visiting homes of students living in poor neighborhoods to invite them to join.
I received a brochure about the class and I wanted my grandson to be able to attend. Our family doesn't have much money, but I want him to study as much as he can.
To offer classes for high school students unable to afford private tutoring, the Ciji Myanmar Liaison Office has been busy organizing courses and inviting teachers since last November. They began renting this space at the beginning of this year in preparation and have now begun offering free tutoring for 28 children.
I want to finish high school and middle school and then go on to university. I want to be an economist and someone that my family can rely on.
If they begin working without a high school diploma, then their salaries are guaranteed to be low. But if we can get them through high school, then they have a shot at university, and their opportunities to make a good income later will be greatly improved. With better income, they can help their families out of poverty.
Education is, of course, the best solution to alleviate the problem of poverty. As tutoring begins in March, there is also a group of volunteer mothers looking after them as if they were family.
Since the students don't need to spend money to receive this kind of supplemental study course, the students here should treasure this opportunity to learn. The students are receiving help from others, so they should try to pay this love forward in the future to help the less fortunate.
Tsuji and these teachers here are committed to helping these young students realize their dreams, while also looking after the situation of their families and helping uplift communities in Myanmar.
In Taiwan, a special ceremony was recently held to commemorate the opening of Xiqi Community Elder Care Center in Taichung's Dajia. The center also has plans to collaborate with Taichung Tsuji Hospital in the future to safeguard local seniors' health.
1, 2, 3.
The Community Elder Care Center in Xiqi Community of Taichung's Dajia officially opens its doors, where local residents aged 65 or above have been invited to attend this celebration. This is the Elder Care Center established by Tsuji in western Taiwan. In the future, this center will collaborate with Taichung Tsuji Hospital to safeguard the health of the elderly in this community.
As people suffering from dementia usually have difficulty communicating with others, they may become a burden for their family. We should take good care of our brain and also stay strong and healthy.
The elderly people in this community not only attend this activity as participants, but they also work as volunteers.
This is wheat gluten, pickled cabbage, and choy sum. We are cooking mapo tofu here.
While Mrs. Lin is a kitchen volunteer, her husband and daughter-in-law also joined to volunteer at the check-in area.
Master Zheng Yan shows great support to take care of the elderly and to prevent dementia. We also agree with this idea.
Besides encouraging seniors to frequently interact with others and exercise their bodies, this center also provides some lessons for them to learn, allowing everyone to live and learn.
Staying in central Taiwan, at the Taichung Jingshi Hall, volunteers are preparing to install a new environmentally friendly sprinkler system for the grounds. However, before the system can be installed, volunteers first have to remove a layer of interlocking bricks. They recently got together to complete the task and clean the bricks.
Among these volunteers cleaning this brick parking lot, one little volunteer is particularly conspicuous, dressed in pink and wielding her broom. She is helping other volunteers clean up the sand that has collected in cracks between the bricks. She accompanied her grandmother today to help out volunteers.
When there are gaps between the bricks, we will collect the sand to fill them in. When you drive over it, there is no sound, and it is always getting pressed down, so it won't look like there is a lot.
On the other side of the Jingshi Hall grounds, a team is preparing for their primary task, installing an automatic sprinkler system.
With this system, it will require less manual labor, and the water that we use is recycled rainwater.
In order to lay the pipework, volunteers must first remove the brick layer before the system installation. Over the past 4 years of being driven over by so many cars, the brick surface has become uneven.
We have to brush them off first, and then after that, when we relay them in the future, they will all fit together more neatly and will all lay evenly.
After using small brushes to clean them, the bricks will be relayed evenly and firmly. The volunteers have been working hard in the hot sun throughout the day. One volunteer is 77 years old.
I have been doing manual labor since I was very young. Today's work was a piece of cake.
With everyone's hard work and cooperation, the installation project will be complete in 3 days.
While cabbage prices have collapsed in recent months in Taiwan, cabbage grown in the mountainous areas has been able to maintain a relatively higher price. This is because it is favored by consumers as low temperatures lead to slow maturation and a naturally sweet taste. In summer, nearly all of the cabbage sold is advertised as high mountain grown. Today, we take you to one of the first areas in Taiwan to plant such a cabbage, Yilan's Nanfang Tribal Village, to get a closer look at their prized cabbage fields.
The temperature is cool and the sun has yet to rise, though all these indigenous men are using headlamps to manually harvest this cabbage. Bending over and neatly cutting off the stem, this cabbage is put into baskets that can hold 30 kilograms. Using a pole set across their shoulders to help them transport this cabbage, it's not the type of work for everyone, as these workers have developed special muscles and their skin has also gotten darker because of this work in the fields.
It's July when we start to harvest or have work every day. Yes, that's correct. We get daily paid for our work. We don't get paid by the month.
These nomadic indigenous groups have become farm workers skilled at harvesting crops. They're sort of subcontractors assigned this work when it comes to harvest season for mountain cabbage.
Low elevation harvest starts in the beginning of April, and there's a break in the middle. High elevation harvest is from August to September around Fushou San.
Yilan County's Datong Township, Nansan, Siji, and Maoan Tribe are all from the Shuishan Range and Nanhu Mountain, an elevation of 800 to 1,200 meters above sea level. This area has abundant water throughout the year and a very moderate temperature, which is quite suitable for producing winter-type vegetables. In the past, Han Chinese would come to this area and rent the fields and plant vegetables to earn a good profit. In the past few years, things have changed.
In the past, indigenous people didn't have any money, but now they know the value of the land and can plant the fields. In the past, some young people who work as drivers have come back to this area.
Yilan's mountainous area is mostly populated by the Atayal tribe, who account for 90% of the population. They live off this farming and do everything from preparing the fields, fertilization, preparing the next planting seedlings, and other work. Many have stayed in their tribe to plant these vegetables for a livelihood, such as Wang Meiyun.
I used to plant over by Lanyang Creek, and together with this area, we have about more than 5 hectares. This is all done by me and my husband.
Datong Township has some 490 hectares of land for cultivating wild cabbage, Chinese cabbage, and spinach. This means that this area can supply the market nearly year-round, with May to November being the main growing season.
This variety in early autumn commands the best price down in the market. In this high-altitude area, when it's so hot, we can't plant the species, as we need to wait until the winter to plant.
The head of this cabbage is pointed, which is one of the most identifiable features of this mountain cabbage. Because temperatures are low, there is slow growth and it accumulates more sugar, making it particularly sweet. In the summer, the high temperature of the plains makes it hard for vegetables to grow, along with the susceptibility to typhoons. For many years, these farmers in the mountains have been able to offer a better product to earn profits.
At around the end of May in the south, they begin to harvest, and then from May to August is our harvest season.
This important farming area actually began in 1957 as part of a program to improve agriculture in Yilan's Datong Township. Later, along the central, southern, and northern cross-island highways, a number of high-elevation cabbage fields were created. Amongst them, Nantou's Renai Township at 2,000 meters above sea level is the largest cabbage field. According to the township office survey, about 10 years ago, there were 350 hectares planted, though now it has grown to 500 hectares.
This area had a lot of fruit trees, but times changed, and fruit trees have less economic value, as they were cut down and high-altitude cold weather vegetables were planted.
High-altitude cabbage does in fact suffer from the fact that farmers rely upon middlemen who typically take a lot of the profit from their hard work. This means they have to put their fate into the hands of others to determine pricing. Occasionally, they may sell directly to tourists who visit the area, as more education for consumers is needed to truly understand the unique features of this delicious cabbage grown in the mountains.
Gwandu District, the area where Jilin River and Tamsui River meet, has a sanctuary for birds and many mangroves. The mangrove roots are capable of grabbing silt in the river, but this in turn makes the river narrow. To solve this problem, the Hydraulic Engineer Office of Taipei City Government planned to clear away some mangroves and silt to help the biodiversity of this wetland.
The mangroves on one hand protect the nature around them, but because they are dominant plants, they are slowly changing the wetlands.
If the mangroves grow too densely, they will terrestrialize the wetlands, and that is bad for the local biodiversity. So after we clear them away, we can help increase animals and plants in the future.
The environment we refer to is for all living species, not just the mangroves, but also other fish, birds, and animals living at the bottom of the river.
This phenomenon will threaten the lives of hundreds of living species of the wetland. Around 31 years ago, this area was designated as sanctuary to protect the resting area for water birds. But as time went by, the mangroves continued to grow, and this area has expanded to 55 hectares and are also making the river narrow. With its closest point only 250 meters away from Shezi Island, therefore, the Hydraulic Engineer Office plans to release 10 hectares, or 18% of the mangrove area, and add 60 meters to the watercourse.
We'll clear away 10 hectares of mangrove, including the silt underneath. Then the river will be able to flow smoothly.
After the work is done, it can improve the drainage in the area and maintain the biodiversity, so birds and fish are able to find their food more easily.
The founder of Dharma Seal Temple in Los Angeles, Dharma Master Ying Hai, has passed away on February 25th. Ordained as a monastic since he was 12, Dharma Master Ying Hai has written and translated 48 books and spread Dharma teachings to different corners of the world. In Taiwan, a memorial service was also held on his behalf in Fuyen Abode in Hsinchu.
The founder of Boca Dharma Seal Temple in Los Angeles, the United States, has passed away at the age of 91 on February 25th. At his funeral, his disciple Dharma Master Hong Zhen reads out loud the funeral oration.
You won't pay attention to me because you've fallen asleep. After completing your mission, you've let go of attachments to return to Pure Land.
The funeral service is attended by more than 800 Dharma masters and Buddhist practitioners.
We are deeply grieved to have lost such a good mentor. It is the loss of the Buddhist community.
Since Zhiji was established in the United States, Dharma Master Ying Hai and other Dharma masters at the Dharma Seal Temple have given us much help and formed great partnership with us in different Zhiji missions.
In Taiwan, a memorial service is held on March 17th at the Fuyen Abode on behalf of Dharma Master Ying Hai.
As the abbot, Dharma Master Ying Hai moved tables and chairs and wiped the floor with us. Thinking back, I am deeply grateful to Dharma Master Ying Hai for his compassion and tolerance.
Having endured all kinds of adversity, Dharma Master Ying Hai has persevered in spreading Buddhist teachings. He has learned about compassion and wisdom from Dharma Master Cihang and Venerable Ying Shun. Now people also revere him as a mentor in their hearts.
The Gro Harlem Brundtland Award recognizes important research of female scholars for the benefit of humankind. One recipient, Yan Yijun, was the first Taiwanese person to ever receive the award.
Standing before the crowd and eloquently explaining her research in neuroscience is Yan Yijun. Her hard work was recently recognized and affirmed this year when she was awarded the Gro Harlem Brundtland Award, being also the first Taiwanese person to receive the award.
I think women have a generally heightened sensitivity, which is often different from that of men. So as women, we can apply that more sensitive perspective to different areas to provide a deeper appreciation of something, as well as a different angle of perspective.
At this year's ceremony, there were 5 award recipients, including the Yemeni scholar Fatia Zakam. Ms. Zakam has overcome national political strife and public health challenges to help develop vaccines to safeguard the health of Yemeni people. Other participants include Phyllis Awar from Uganda and Wafa Al-Jamal from Jordan. Ms. Awar overcame traditional pressures of her society to help better plan health policies for women and children. Ms. Wafa Al-Jamal promoted research on cancer medicine and targeted care techniques. And the last recipient was Farah Fatima from India, who has been teaching youth in rural villages how to measure and monitor blood pressure to help reduce the risk of cardiovascular disease, while helping the Indian government train local staff to help prevent disease.
We have decreased level of physical activity because of urbanization, improvement in transport mechanisms. So people walk less, people play less. So a combination of decreased physical activity and unhealthy food has led to increase in the obesity, increase in diabetes rates, increase in hypertension rates. And all this put together has led to an increase in the cardiovascular and other non-communicable diseases.
These remarkable ladies represent a growing number of women in the scientific community who are overcoming barriers, using their own creativity and ingenuity to conduct valuable research for the benefit of all humankind.
New Taipei City's Sanjiao community is an early coal mining region of the north. Recently, a project to renovate the old Sanjiao station was completed, and now it's open to the public for new and old rail enthusiasts alike.
These tourists are enjoying taking pictures with the old station master's uniform.
It's a historic site, so I wanted to bring him here to experience it and see the trains.
Shulin Sanjiao train station was built in the Japanese colonial period. Due to the wear and tear of the weather, the main frame of the structure was damaged to where the roof was infested with termites. To preserve the historic monument, the Cultural Affairs Bureau and the Taiwan Railway Bureau jointly partnered on remodeling efforts, combining the Japanese-style wooden building with the Western cement construction techniques. After a year's work, the station is back to its former glory.
The chairs and some walls were preserved and weren't damaged. We only refurbished the exterior.
It brings back memories of this old train station and those who rode on the trains. We want the children to understand this old train station and the importance it played in terms of transportation for the local community.
Now the waiting room can reach the new station, and each day about 2,000 to 3,000 tourists stop by, similar to how it was in its coal mining heyday.
The coal mines in this area were very abundant. You can say that Sanjia, Yingge and Sanxia districts are coal mining districts in its earlier days. It was where the laborers lived.
Inside the old station, an artist has replicated the old station in a wooden model, while the ticket counter is sure to elicit more memories. This exhibit, filled with scenes of olden days, is sure to attract more visitors to come.
In the United States, a Vietnamese-Chinese Ciji volunteer has been steadily canvassing donations for Ciji for the past 2 years. At the end of the program, we follow her as she visits the shops in hopes more people donate a bit of their love. That's all the time we have for today. Thank you for joining us. Goodbye.